Aces high. Give it just a couple of seconds here.
same old dry existence, the same old dry experience with God.
Everybody, it is another wonderful Wednesday that we have been blessed to see, and we are excited about this midweek inspiration that we get to share and receive on tonight. And I hope something is said that we could be blessed so much the more that we can have a closer walk with God as we continue through the rest of our week. Listen, I thank you all so much for your faithfulness and your continued support of those that continue to log on for Wednesday night. I have a good time on Wednesday night. I look forward to it, and I'm just, I know I love Sunday, but sometimes Wednesdays are just as good for me, amen, just to help get on through the rest of the week. To get our cups filled back up. So listen, we're going to go a little further. We're going to have a word of prayer, and then we're going to go right into it. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, how we thank you for this another day's journey. God, we thank you for what you've done for us thus far. Oh God, we thank you for how you've kept us, how you watched over us. Oh God, how you've given us traveling grace day after day so far. Oh God, we thank you just for looking beyond all of our faults and still supplying us with all of our needs. Now, God, we pray right now that you would forgive us again for our unforgiven sins. God, we pray that you would consecrate our hearts, our minds, open our hearts and our ears, oh God, that we can be receptive to your word, that we can take something and apply it to our everyday living, that we may have a closer walk with you. Now, God, it is my personal prayer, God, that you just have thine own way. God, that you move upon me, that these your people may see you and not me, oh God. We pray for every household that's represented. God, we pray that you just let your anointing fall fresh on each and every one of us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. Listen, this week there's a word that has been placed within my heart, within my mind, that just been saying and just been kind of thinking about, and that word is courage. I mean, courage is something that is required for us to be successful. Courage is something that that's needed for us to take leaps of faith, for us to move, for us to be able to do the things that God would have us to do, for us to be able to just continue to push forward day by day. It requires courage to be able to do all of these things. If we lack courage, if we get too consumed with fear, it's going to stop our progress. It's going to stop where we're trying to get to. It's going to just about put a stronghold on us, because we've allowed fear to overtake us when we are designed to be full of courage. We are designed to be bold people. We are designed to be ready and able to say, listen, God, wherever you lead me, I am willing to follow. But we have to have courage even when the odds are against us. And that's where it gets a little tricky. That's where it gets a little shady, because now we almost know that, especially in those instances when you know that the odds are against me and I'm probably not going to succeed. When it's in those instances where the word courage jumps out to me, that God has embedded within us the ability to succeed. Again, even when the odds are against us, with the help of God, we should know and understand that we can overcome anything. It doesn't matter what it is, doesn't matter what's laid before you. With the help of God, we can overcome anything. With our courage laid out in Him, with our courage leaning and depending on Him, with our courage and our hope and our faith residing and being pulled from the very instance of what He's placed within us, we can overcome anything. I realize that, man, the devil gets busy. I realize that he is going to seek and destroy. He's going to attack. He's going to try to take us out. He's going to try to do all of these things. I realize that it's one of the schemes of the enemy. The scheme of the enemy is pretty much across the board. It's true for everybody. It's across the board in all of our lives that the scheme of the enemy is to attack. And then he's going to attack the things in our lives or certain aspects in our lives that we need the most, which is courage. If he can attack our courage, if he can attack that, and if he can take that out, guess what? He will have won half the battle already, because we've already conceded to the fear. We've already given in to the fact that we might not make it. We've already allowed these seeds to be sown in our mind of saying that I'm not going to get to what I'm trying to get to. Why? Because we allow fear to have stepped in and overtaken our courage. For me, I'll just share, for me in ministry, in trying to do the will of God and trying to do, what God would have me to do, which is teach, which is preach, which is give, the word of God to the people of God so that they could be moved and come running saying, Lord, what must I do to be saved or to just be strengthened in their walk? For me in ministry and also throughout just whatever good I desire to do, I found out that one of the most difficult things is the enemy is going to get busy. He is going to try to discredit you. He is going to try to take you out. And in those instances, when they happen, they are so disheartening. They are so frustrating. They're so, it's just disappointing to the fact to where it almost takes you out. It almost has you asking the question, Lord, is this what you want me to do? Lord, do I really need to do this? And it gets to the point to even where you don't want to do it. And I can just speak for me. You get to the point to where you don't want to do it. You set out these particular goals. You set out these things and you follow the will. God may have placed something in your heart and said, listen, I want you to go and do this. And you may ask the question, Lord, you sure this what you want me to do? And you decide, Lord, I am going to do what it is that you would have me to do. But what I found out is when you try, the more and more you try to do good, I believe it says that evil is always present. But even in the midst of that, the more and more you try to do good and it starts to fail, it starts to falter, it starts to slow down, it starts to fall short, it starts to get to a point to where it seems like it's not gonna work, we tend to stop and start to listen to other people. We start to listen to what's going on around us. We start to look at what's happening around us. We start to look at the negativity, or we start to look at where it's starting to stop at. And then you start to concede and you realize that, well, maybe it's not going to work. Maybe this is not going to happen. Maybe this is not what God really said to do. Maybe I misheard. Maybe I didn't understand. But what I found out is, it's interesting how God will begin to speak to you. It's interesting how he'll begin to tap you on your shoulder and remind you that he's the one who has given you the ability to do what he wants you to do. He's the one. He's going to come in and he's going to challenge you. He's going to let you do everything possible to try to overcome, to try to succeed in the task that he's given you. But when you start to fall short, he's going to step in and he's going to start to challenge you and cause your mind to think about the plan that he has, the plan that he set forth. As a matter of fact, he'll boldly just come out and ask you, well, but who did I call? And to hear God stop and ask you the question, but who did I call? Who did I say go do this? It's right then your courage should increase, your ability to say, listen, you sure right, God. You called me to do this, and I should be listening to you and nobody else. Listen, you've called me to go and reach the masses. You called me to go and help other families. You've called me to do, and I don't know what he's actually called you to do. I don't know what he's told you to do, but I realize that all of us have the same effect because we're all human, we're all flesh, we all listen, we all fall short, we all get in our own way, but I realize that every now and again, all of us need the encouragement to listen, to stop and listen to God ask us the question, but who did I call? Many people have missed out on blessings. Many people have missed out on accomplishing major goals that could have helped so many people along the way. Why? Because we looked at the entirety of the scheme of everything that's happening and we got overwhelmed. We got nervous. We started to back off of it because we didn't think that it was going to succeed. But when we stop and we listen to God say, but who did I call? And that's a personal question. He's going to ask you in particular. He asked me in particular, but who did I call? Then you stop and you begin to think about it. And here it is. Most times it's not even what other people may be saying about you. It's not even what God has said about you. It's what you believe God says about you. It doesn't matter what anybody else say. The truth of the matter is, it's what we believe. It's what's in our heart. It's what's in our mind. It's what we're processing. It's what we're either building it up or we're tearing it down. We're doing one of the two things. And the most important thing to realize is it's not based upon anybody else but ourselves. It's based upon how you feel. It's based upon, look, God could have told you clear as day, clear, just plain and simple, and laid out the whole plan in front of you. But somewhere in there, our flesh gets weak and we start to think. It's as simple as that. We start to think and we will have thought ourselves out of the plan. We will have thought the negativity and what it really is that's jumping out and stopping us is simply fear. Fear will have taken us out. Fear will have hurt us. Fear will have done so much to us when it shouldn't have. I mean, God can tell us. He can tell us all day long. He can tell us that what he's called us to do. He can tell us that your purpose. He can tell you everything all laid out. But until we believe it, what God is trying to tell us, until we believe what God has told us, the enemy is going to continue an attack, and he's going to continue to come in. He said, I can see the devil now saying, listen, I see a little doubt there. I see a little hesitation there. I'm going to jump in, and I'm going to get in their head. I'm going to get in their mind, and I'm going to mess them up. Because why? He wants to destroy your belief. That's what he wants to do. He wants to destroy your belief. He's after our courage and about what God has said to us, what he's promised to us, what he's going to do. He wants us to doubt all of the thing that God has called us to do. It's as simple as that. That's his goal. And if he can cause us to start to doubt, again, he's gaining ground in the battle. He's knocking us off. He's making us sit down. He's making us get discouraged. He's making us starting to get to a point of understanding and saying, man, I'm getting frustrated. I'm getting tired. I have headaches. I want to sit down. I don't want to do it no more. He's doing this through the process of simply taking away our courage of what we're able to do and what God has said we can do and filling it with doubt and fear. That's his job. That's what he's going to do. That's how he's going to attack us. That's how he's going to take us out. But until we, once we build up a level of courage, once we build up the ability to say, listen, I'm going to truly lean and depend on God. I'm going to stand on the promises of God and what he said and what he told me to go and do. I realize that he's going to give me the ability and the strength to do it. I just have to have the courage. And it's not going to be easy. I wish I could tell you to be easy. I wish I could tell you to be a walk in the park. But what I can tell you is that we have to continue to look to God for our courage. We have to continue to look. As a matter of fact, there's a story that is told about a young lady who was she was fresh out of jail, and she had children, and she was fresh out of jail, and she was trying to get her life together. She was trying to do it, and she ended up getting a job. She ended up doing well. She got this job, and she was doing great in this job, but God had already started to instill some things within this lady while she was in prison. She was in prison. She was teaching. She was preaching. She was telling people about God, and she was helping them along the way. But when she got out of jail, she, of course, as normal, we all have to try to figure out how to get back into society, how to take care of our family. So that's exactly what she did. She got this job. She was doing well. She was moving up within the company. And then one day God reached out, and God in a dream told her, this is what she said, that God came and told her to quit her job. Now, I understand that in today's society, it's a blessing to have a job. I get it. You got kids, you got things, you got family, you got bills, and to have a job is something that seems to be so important. But she said that the Lord came to her in a dream and told her that to quit her job. And watch this. Flesh, as normal, which I would have to say I would probably do the same thing. A lot of us would have said the same thing. The question came up, Lord, you sure you want me to quit my job? Or even better yet, like she did in her story, Lord, I don't think I can do that. I don't think I can quit my job. I don't think I can just walk away. I've built myself back up. I'm doing well. I'm taking care of my children. And the Lord said, are you going to quit your job today? Told her, She said the Lord told her clear as day. And of course, she woke up the next morning thinking about it. The Bible, the story says that, it's not in the Bible, but the story says that she woke up and she was thinking about it. And she was as she was getting dressed, she was constantly thinking like, surely the Lord didn't tell me that last night. Maybe I just made it up. And she's thinking, but no, it's laying heavy on her heart. She's driving her kids to school and she makes it to her job. She drops her kids off, makes it to her job. She's sitting out in the parking lot. Before she gets ready to go in, she's still thinking about this. She finally, it's starting to build up so much, she grabbed the steering wheel and just squeezed it and started screaming and just said, listen, I can't do it. I'm not gonna do it. And as simple as that, Lord, I can't do it. She went on and she went into the building like she would normally do day after day, and she was sitting in her office getting ready to do her work, and she was doing what she had to do. And she said she was sitting there and her boss walked by. Boss walked by, spoke or whatever. Then boss stopped and backed back up and looked at her and said, you have something you need to tell me? And she knew what had been said. She knew what had been laid on her heart. She knew what was going on. But again, we're all human. We're all we flesh. We not all the way there yet. She said she looked at her boss and said, "No, ma'am, I ain't got nothing to tell you." Said I ain't got nothing to tell you at all. But the boss looked at her again and said, "No, you have something to tell me." And told her to come to her office. Lady goes inside her office and she's sitting there with her boss and she said, yeah, you have something to tell me. And she ultimately ended up telling her that she was going to resign from her position. Obviously, this is not what the boss thought that she was going to say because of the confused look on her face. And she was looking like trying to figure it out. And they talked a little more. And ultimately, she said, yeah, the Lord came and told me, he said that I was going to quit my job today. And she looked and trying to figure her out, saying, how are you going to say, what kind of God will tell you that to quit your job and you're ex-con and you just got out of prison and now you're doing good? What kind of God? And she began to ask herself the same question. You're right. What kind of God would tell me to quit my job when I'm doing so good? What kind of God would tell me to quit my job when I got kids to take care of? What kind of God would tell me to do that? Boss, they're sitting there talking. Boss, yeah, ain't nobody else going to hire you. And then finally, something clicked in the midst of her asking the question of what kind of God would have me to quit my job. And she looked around and the boss again said, yeah, because who's going to hire you? She realized and she looked at her and she said, well, you hired me. And she went on and resigned. Gathered her things, walked out, and as she got ready to, she went on out. And of course, she said this happened on a Wednesday. Still trusting in God. Said on Friday, she got a call. And they wanted to interview. Talked to her, interviewed her. Saturday, she went. They had another interview. Sunday, she got hired doing ministry work. She got hired and been doing it ever since. But the thing is, it took her to have courage enough in God to say, God, you've given me a purpose. God, you've given me what you want me to do. You've given me the ability to do. Now I just have to do. I have to listen to your will. I have to listen to your way. I have to listen to what you poured out into me to be able to do it. But what we fail to understand is, even in like this story, what we fail to understand is what sometimes what it seems to be a difficult task, what seems to be something that's going to stop us dead in our tracks and we won't be able to succeed, we won't be able to provide, we won't be able to go forward. Sometimes if we just stop and listen to God and do what God would have us to do, He will make every provision. He'll make every provision for you to move forward. He'll make every provision for you to be successful. He'll give you whatever it is that you lack to be able to succeed in that. I believe it said, whom God calls, He also qualifies, which means He's going to give you the necessary tools to be successful and help everybody else along the way. But we have to have the courage. We have to have the ability to walk with them and talk with them. Now watch this. Here, it gets even better. When God gives us something, when we pray, when we ask God to bless us with these things, when we ask God to elevate us, when we ask God to enlarge our territory, when we ask God to just take us to the next level, if it's the relationship with Him, if it's whatever it is, when we ask God to do these things, oftentimes we have to understand that God, whatever He's calling you to, whatever He's going to give you, sometimes we have to understand that it will often be packaged in difficulties. It won't be an easy walk. It won't be an easy just thrown in your lap and it's going to happen. What's going to happen is you're going to have the courage. You're going to need the courage to step into what God is calling you to. We have to get past the fear. We have to get past that, because in everything else, on the other side of fear, I believe it's a cliche that says on the other side of fear is your success. On the other side of fear is your destiny. On the other side of fear is your breakthrough. On the other side of fear is what you've been praying for. On the other side of fear is everything that you need to be successful, because now you have the courage, and your courage is not in yourself, but your courage and your hope and your faith is all in God. And that's where it is. We have to operate in courage. We have to operate in that. And it's shown throughout the Bible. It's shown all in there. You remember when Joshua was taken over for Moses, when he was called, Joshua was like, listen, I don't feel qualified to follow behind Moses. I don't feel like I should be the one getting ready to lead these people behind Moses. Listen, I wasn't qualified, but God had to even tell him. This is how hard-headed we are sometimes. But God even had to tell him, listen, have I not commanded you? God had to tell him like seven times, I believe it was, that because, and he had to tell him seven times, not because he was disobedient, it was because of his fear. It was because of him being afraid, and he had to help develop and reassure him. And sometimes we have to listen. He told Joshua, listen, have I not commanded you? God expects us to be courageous. He expects us to stand boldly. He expects us to do what He told us to do. Why? Because, again, He said so. And how is it that I can operate in courage? How is it that we should be able to operate in courage? It's because it's simple. It's because God is with us. God is right there with us. He's walking with us. He's talking. As a matter of fact, I believe it said, if God be with us, then who or what can be against us? That alone should give you the courage. God is saying to somebody right now, have I not commanded you? Have I not told you that I'll be with you? Have I not told you to be strong and courageous? Because the Lord is going to go with you. He's saying, have I not told you? Listen, even when we get in our own feelings, even when we start to doubt, we ought to stop and go back through and say, listen, listen to him saying, have I not told you? Didn't I not tell you? As a matter of fact, we can look at this. It's a strong spirit that we work against. That fear is a strong spirit that we work against. It's the fear of the unknown. It's the fear of what's going to happen if it doesn't work out the way it should. It's the fear of you falling short and now having to figure out how to rebound. But if we are being led by God, if we're being taught by him, if we're listening to him and not nobody else, not ourselves, not our friends, not anybody. Listen, if we're listening to him, our courage should be built up to a point to where we can literally walk boldly and tell the devil and look the devil in the obstacles and everything else that comes our way and have them say, hey, be thou removed. It's a strong spirit that we're operating against, but here it is. We don't have to. We don't have to. Isaiah 41 and 10, I'm going to read this one. Isaiah 41 and 10 says, so do not fear. I'm reading from the NIV. Isaiah 41:10 says, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Did you catch all of that that was in there? Look at what God is saying. None of the things, none of those things was based upon us. None of the things that he said was based upon us and our individual capabilities. None of the things that he said was based upon nothing that we are capable of doing. But all of the things that he said in that verse, all was based upon him and him alone. It's him saying that he is going to provide everything that we need. He is going to provide all of that. So do not fear, for I am with you. He's going to walk with you. He's going to talk with you. He's going to be standing by your side. And if he's standing by your side, your courage should be increased. Why? Because he's saying, I'm with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. He's telling you, I'm your Father, which is in heaven. Because you are my child, I'm going to lean and you can lean and depend on me. I'm going to be your leaning post. I've got you. I'll be there. And when you get tired, he says, I will strengthen you and help you, which means I'm going to give you what you need to overcome and endure whatever's coming your way. And then he says, I will uphold you, which means you will not fail. You won't fail. He's going to withhold me with his righteous hand. Righteous right hand. I got you. So none of those things are based upon our ability. If we have faith and hope and courage in our Lord and courage in what we're doing, none of the things that we get in the way and mess up, it's not even gonna matter, because where we fall short, he's going to step in and take the rest of the way. Where we feel like, but we cannot allow fear to destroy us. We can't allow fear to stop us in our path. We can't allow fear to hold us down. We don't, and watch this. That particular scripture was good because it's a reminder that we don't have the strength. We don't have the ability. We don't have, if you thought and you look at anybody who's successful, if you look at anybody who may be elevated, if you look at any of these people that may seem like they're, it was nothing by their own might. It was by the will of God, by the grace of God, by the mercy of God, that everybody that is successful, that did anything, that come, it's by him. It's by his design. It's by what he wants. We don't have the strength to face some of the things that we have to face. It's as simple as that. We don't have the ability. Listen, when our loved ones pass away, when we have to put someone in the ground that we loved and care about so dearly, that is an unbearable moment. Why? Because that is one of our loved ones. It's unbearable, but by the strength of God and by the trusting in him, we're able to endure. We're able to make it through. If we have to go through any storms, trials, obstacles, whatever, it's because if we lean and depend on him, he'll give us the strength to go through it. We can't go through it alone. And if you try to go through it alone, you're going to be in it for a while. So I might as well just go on and start out. Hey, God, here we go. I need you. And that's where my courage comes in. That's when I start to realize, listen, if you go back through the Bible, listen, we Moses, just like us, we don't have the strength to part seas. We don't have the strength to walk on water. We didn't have the strength to go against the Goliaths that comes our lives, but he does. And he's telling us, I'm with you. I'm going to strengthen you. I'm your God. I got you. You're my child, and I'm going to uphold you. But the enemy gets us, and he has us sometimes wrapped up in fear. He has us wrapped up in this spirit of fear. And when we get wrapped up in the spirit of fear, it paralyzes us. Fear restricts us. Fear blinds you. Fear stops you from operating the way God created you to. Fear causes you to stand still. Fear causes you to not even try. Fear causes you to just want to give up. Fear causes you to want to just all of the negative aspect of it is once fear gets a hold to you, all of these things start to happen and you're fine and you're trying to figure out, why is it that I'm stuck in this rut? Why is it that I can't move forward? Why is it that I've been struggling for so long? Why? Maybe it's because of the fear that has consumed you. And I challenge you to try just being courageous. Try just stepping out there and saying, listen, God, because you said so, I am going to do this. You think Peter could have walked on that water? No, Peter couldn't have walked on that water, but he was courageous enough to listen to God that said, that bidded him to come towards him. He was courageous enough to say, because you said it, God, I'm going to step out on this water. I can imagine even the folk around Peter trying to pull him back. Listen, you can't walk on water. Don't you go out there. But he listened to God and not him. And when he put his foot out on the water, when he was courageous in that moment to trust God and put his foot out there on the water and he began to walk to him, he was successful. He was successful in taking a few steps on water. But we can't. We have to stay focused. We have to keep moving. We have to say, block out everything. Other noise that's going on and stay focused, because when Peter got out there and he started listening and he started watching and he started to get a little wary, he began to sink and had to reach out and say, Lord, help me. But we have to be courageous. We have to listen to him. And the enemy wants to keep us in the fear. The enemy wants to restrict us. He wants to stop us. He wants to keep us away from God. And he'll wrap us up like a python snake with fear and just restrict us. And try his best to squeeze every bit of courage out of us. But I'm thankful through the power and authority of Jesus Christ that we should be full of courage. We need courage. We need it. We need it to face the things that come in our lives. We need it because whatever we're facing is obviously going to be bigger than us. We need it because we can't handle none of this stuff on our own. So we need the courage and the faith in God to say, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. So to have this courage, it's important. I don't know why this word was on my heart. I don't know why this word was on my mind, but it was something that said, I got to have courage. Because whatever it is that we try to do, whatever it is that we're trying to go, you notice that you have to put forth an effort. You have to put forth some work. Nothing is handed to you. Everything that we want always seems to be just wrapped up in difficulties. It takes the courage to peel back every layer of difficulty that's wrapped around what you're trying to accomplish. But watch this. The courage to make it through those difficulties, the difficulties that are in place, they're not there to distract us. They're not there to harm us. They're not there to keep us down, but they're there to make us appreciate. They're there to make us appreciate whatever it is once we get it. Once we get it, we can be thankful. We can say, I didn't do this on my own. It took the help of God. It took the help. And because he blessed me and took me through it, it builds up my courage even more for my next task. It builds up my faith even more for knowing that God still holds, he still loves me. He still cares for me. He's still leading me. He's still guiding me. He's still going to take me where I need to go if I just trust, obey, and listen to him. Not gonna come with ease. It's not gonna come with ease. But through our courage, through our hope, and our faith in him. When God calls us to different things, when God tells you he wants you to do something, when he tells you he wants you to move in a certain direction, when he tells you he has something in store for you and he's going to equip you to do this, that, and the other, understand that it's not going to be easy. That's why we need the courage. God didn't call us to everything just to be easy. But what he has called us to is to his destiny, to our destiny of what God wants us to have. And in order for you to get there, you have to have the courage. In order for you to get there, you have to trust him. This last thing, we already know the scripture says, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of love, power, and sound mind. Courage. Trust God. Lean on him. Follow him. Look to God for your courage. Don't look to nobody else. Don't look anywhere else. Look to God for your courage. And once you have that, you can stand boldly and say, come on, devil, bring it on. Bring what you got for me, devil. I'm ready for you. Because I'm standing on the true foundation, the solid rock of my Lord and Savior. I'm standing on him. I'm standing on his promises. I'm going to take him at his word. That on the other side of my fear, on the other side of my difficulties, is my destiny. Amen. Listen, I hope something was said on tonight that you could take it and apply it to your everyday living. I hope something was said that increased your courage on tonight to let you know that God is still in control, that God still loves you, God still cares, God wants you to just continue to hold on to him. I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to listen to God, walk with God, go with God. And watch him see you all the way through. Lord have mercy. Listen, Just real quick, I have a couple of quick announcements that I want to get out, and then I am going to pray us out of here, and we'll go through the rest of this week filled with the power and the ability of knowing that God loves me and he has the ability to take me where he wants me to go. And because of that, my courage is more so that I can make it. Please be in prayer for our pastor. Continue prayers for him that God continues to touch him. We're also being in prayer for Mother Josephine Thomas Garrett, whose son-in-law passed away, and they will be having his services on this weekend. There's a viewing on Friday from 3 to 8 at the Evergreen Funeral Home, and then on Saturday, the Celebration of Life will be at the River of Life Church in DeSoto at 11 a.m. So please lift the Garrett family up at this time. Continue to tell them, call them by name, that God will be the comforter that we know that he is and will be. Amen. Also, let us be reminded that we have our Team Up the Cleanup event that is coming on May 15th. So it's the weekend after this coming weekend, on Saturday from 9 to 1. We look forward to having good fellowship and just coming out and sprucing up, cleaning up a little bit our church so that we could just be able to come into a nice, clean environment and just continue to grow and do what God would have us to do. Listen, I thank you all so much for your continued support and continue to tune in week after week. So thankful and so grateful to each and every one of you. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, how we thank you for this another day's journey. God, we thank you for what you've allowed us to hear on tonight, which involves our courage. God, we pray right now that you would strengthen us, oh God, that you would give us the ability to understand that our hope, our faith, our trust totally lies within you. And when we lean and depend on you in that manner, God, we understand that we can stand boldly on your word and go out and do that you would have us to do. Now, God, I pray a personal prayer for everybody that's watching, oh God, even those that are not, for all of our members, all of our friends, all of our family, God, that you would just continue to strengthen and pour out your love, affection, and whatever that's needed, oh God, in every household, God. We pray that you would be that in the name of Jesus. God, we pray that you would be a lamp unto our feet as we get ready to go into this the rest of the week. God, we pray that you would walk with us and talk with us, that we can forever feel your presence, that we know that you're standing by, and we can combat the devil and the traps and the snares that he may have set before us. Now, God, we pray for our nation. We pray for the sickness that's seemingly getting better. But God, we pray that you would move like only you can. God, we pray that you soften hardened hearts, that you ease confused minds, oh God, that you would just let words of love and your goodwill flow from all of our hearts and our minds, that we could love one another. Now, God, thank you for what you've done on tonight. Thank you for keeping us. Thank you for holding us in the power of your might. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. I don't know about you tonight, but somebody may be crying, but I come to let you know that God can. But God is gonna work it out if you said it in his word. Just a test of your faith.